Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram. Welcome to my channel. This video today is to discuss a few facts about fever. So the video is obviously aimed to educate parents, but from the healthcare professional point of view, if any of you are watching this video, it's more for you to share this information with your families. So I'll be doing it as a PowerPoint presentation. Fever is one of the most common clinical concerns that parents have, and that is one of the main reasons they visit a doctor. So it's very important to know what fever is and how a parent should react to the fever. So fever is nothing but a rise in the body temperature. It's related to a body reaction to potentially harmful stimulus. It can be infection or what the body perceives as a stressful stimulus. It can be like immunization. We may have external factors like overheating, for example, sunstroke in the older kids and heat stroke or in the newborn babies if you are over wrapping them or keeping them in a warm room. This is more important in the initial period when they may be a bit dehydrated as well. So dehydration also provokes your body temperature to go up. Some medications can cause, though it's not common, and some poisonings can produce fever as well. We often attribute low-grade fever to inflammation in the body, similar to what we see with teething. However, please remember that teething doesn't produce high-grade fever. So a little rise in body temperature can also be seen in the evenings. So the morning body temperature is a bit cooler compared to what we get in the evening. So this is another factor that you should look at, 0.5 degree centigrade difference. So physical activity, external environmental factors like being in the sun or in a hot car for some time, minor issues like teething can cause temperature to go up. So in general terms, we don't recommend you to measure the temperature unless you think there is fever, so don't routinely check, and this applies even to the newborn babies. If you feel the baby looks pink and is otherwise not excessively warm, you don't need to measure the temperature. How do we measure the temperature? So this is quite a tricky question because there are so many options that we have currently. The ear infrared thermometers are quite commonly used. After 3 months of age, it's quite convenient. In the younger baby, sometimes the tip may not enter into the ear canal and so the reading may not be accurate. So you have to make an informed decision depending on how small a tip you have. So it's reflective of the core temperature. So from that point of view, it's fairly accurate. And as I said, you need the appropriate sized ear tip. There are the infrared thermometers can be used both in the forehead and on the ear. So you can get these, and these are probably the best option. If the child is sleeping, for example, you don't need to disturb the child by putting the tip in the ear canal. You can check it on the temporal pulse, which is the forehead thermometer. You have the digital thermometers. These are different from the infrared thermometers in that they don't give the reading as quickly. It takes at least 30 seconds to a minute in most instances, so it beeps when it's ready to measure. Until then, you have to keep it in the appropriate place. You can use it for oral use, axillary use, and rectal use. Obviously, if you're using it for a rectal use, you keep it only for the rectal purpose. You wouldn't put it in other areas. And if you have an oral thermometer in a younger child, it's very difficult because they don't want to keep still with something in their mouth for a long time. In older children and adults, oral thermometer is an option. Axillary temperature can be measured in infants as well if they cooperate. So this is the best source, even though the axillary temperature is not as accurate, is slightly lower than the core temperature. The oral temperature is also slightly lower. And we should make sure that we don't measure the oral temperature for at least 15 minutes after they've had something cold or warm to drink, because that would influence the oral temperature. Axillary temperature is likely to be lower if the child is sweating, as the cooling produces evaporation, as the sweating evaporates, and then there is cooling related to that. The rectal temperature is as accurate as the core temperature anywhere else, but it is not routinely used as it is invasive. However, we do use it in the neonatal intensive care unit in some stages, especially most of the low reading thermometers are rectal thermometers. So if you need to check for hypothermia, where the temperature may be, go below 35 degrees, you may need a rectal probe. And the same is used for the cooling therapeutic hypothermia, which we use in some intensive care units for birth asphyxia. There are skin patch thermometers. These are not accurate as they are more affected by ambient factors. It's difficult to calibrate them. So it's like hit and miss. It may give you the right reading, but you can't trust it. So digital thermometers use electronic heat sensors to record the body temperature, and they give a reading in around a minute. The digital ear thermometers, called tympanic thermometers, use infrared ray, and these are quicker. The same infrared ray can be used to measure the temporal artery thermometers, and these are the forehead thermometers. All of us are going through a current crisis with the COVID, and so you are used to getting your temporal artery temperature checked as you go into malls or anywhere else. And we do have the thermal cameras which can record for multiple people at the same time, for example, screening at the entrance of a building and so on. So these are the different thermometers, and some of us who are old enough may remember the old mercury thermometer. So obviously we don't use the mercury thermometer anymore. It was quite fascinating to see the mercury which is in the tip of it rise up, and it indicates the temperature. It does take some time to measure, and usually it was used as a oral or axillary thermometer. And we have, this is a kind of infrared thermometers for the forehead or ear, and you have a tip to add in case of the ear thermometer. These are the digital thermometers, and you can use the same orally or axillary area. You need to clean it appropriately after use. So this is an important part where we discuss the normal body temperature. Obviously, where you measure the temperature makes a difference in terms of the exact readings, but similar to any vital sign reading, we are more worried about the range. We are not worried about an exact number. So a slight difference will not make a big difference in your treatment decision. So the rectal thermometer and the ear thermometers, the readings are going to match the core temperature more or less, and the ear thermometer may be a little lower because of the exposure to the environment. So you can see that the range in Fahrenheit is around 98 to 100 and up to 100.4 for the ear thermometer. So if you measure in the mouth or armpit, it's a little lower. Be familiar with one scale so that you're not confused between Celsius and Fahrenheit. Obviously, the progression is there, but it doesn't exactly correlate. And in terms of fever, in a rectal or ear temperature record, we take 38 degrees Celsius or 100.4 degrees centigrade as fever. And in the mouth, it's more than 37.8. And if it is an armpit recording, you may even take 37.2 and above, or 99 degrees and above as fever. So where you record makes a difference. But as I said, if it's a low-grade fever, if the child is well, you wouldn't influence your treatment based on that. So you don't need to be too concerned about minor variations. So how do we know if the temperature rise is serious? So any fever in a baby under 3 months of age, where you're checking in the central temperature, the core temperature is above 38 degrees Celsius, it needs to be evaluated. So the reason is infections can progress quite rapidly in small babies. You may have a serious infection. If you don't pick it up and treat quickly, you may have a septicemia, and the baby may have rapid progression. So even though it could be a viral infection, even in small babies, especially if you have siblings affected with a cold, for example, we cannot exactly be sure, and it's better to get them checked. From 3 months to 2 years, you can be a little bit more relaxed. If the child looks well in between the fever and is otherwise eating and drinking well, a reduced appetite is normal during the fever. Of course, you have to account for that. If the temperature is below 39 degrees or 102.2 Fahrenheit, you can monitor for 24 hours or so. And if it is an improving trend, you don't necessarily need to consult. In older kids, you can monitor longer if the child is otherwise well. So 2 to 3 days of fever, I mean, if the symptoms do suggest a viral infection like a cold and the fever is not extreme, child is otherwise well, you can manage with the symptomatic treatment. So apart from young infants, the first 3 months, as I told you, you need to show, irrespective of other symptoms. If there is any degree of fever associated with the refusal to eat or drink, and the child seems too ill to drink fluids. So fever can cause dehydration. So if they don't drink adequately, you may get worse. And the other factor is that if they are not even keen to drink because fever causes thirst, it might indicate that they are sick. Their sensorium is affected. So diarrhea, repeated vomiting, as well as any signs of dehydration like reduced urine output, if they are less alert and active than usual, then also you should consider. If the child complains of a specific focus, like sore throat or ear pain, which may mean they have a need for antibiotic possibly, or pain while peeing, which might indicate a urinary tract infection, or a rash in the body, it may be a viral rash, but you need to check for more serious rashes as well, especially if the rash is not blanching. Blanching is the rash changing color when you press on it and release it. So if it's not blanching, it might mean it's like a purpuric rash or a petechiae, which is like a blood leaking into the skin. That might mean a very serious problem like meningococcal meningitis. The baby has a fever after 24 hours under 2 years of age or after 48 to 72 hours in older kids. Again, you need to seek attention. If these situations arise, we may need emergency care. Which means you don't delay, you don't even wait for the OPD to open the next morning, you take them to the emergency. The child is extremely irritable or fussy with the fever. There is sluggishness and trouble waking up, especially if they are appearing limp or refuse to move. Rash, which I described, I mean purple spots like look like petechiae or bruise on the skin. So the glass test, you can keep a glass that we used to drink water on the skin, and if the rash is blanching, you'd see a color change there. It will pale up, and then as you remove the glass, it becomes red again. So this is a blanching rash, and the blanching rash is usually less serious. If it doesn't blanch, it means there is a subcutaneous bleed, blood leak, which may mean more serious infection. If the child has a stiff neck, there is severe headache or seizure, this is also important. Moderate to severe abdominal pain, because fever can be a manifestation of appendicitis, for example, which may need further evaluation. Urinary tract infections can produce abdominal pain as well. So these are conditions where you may need to review, you may need a test, and according to investigation reports, you may need to decide what to do next. If the child has trouble breathing, especially if there is fast breathing or the child appears pale or blue, which may indicate that there is difficulty in getting the oxygenation right, this is also an important step, and you may even need to call the ambulance for conditions like fast breathing where the child color is changing, or if the child has seizures or any signs of brain infection. So obviously fever is a serious concern for parents, and we need to know that it's a manifestation of an underlying process. It's not the problem by itself. And unless the fever is very high, treatment of the fever is for symptom relief only. So our body perceives an infection as something which is noxious, and to fight it, a resetting of the central thermostat. So we have thermostats for our homes for the air conditioning. And so whatever you set, it gets to that range. We are warm-blooded animals, and the body thermostat controls the body temperature maintenance. So if we feel we are in a cold environment, the body starts producing more heat, and fever is in a similar situation where the body perceives that we need to produce more heat to kill the bacteria or viruses which thrive at our body temperature. So it's a battle, and fever is one of our defense mechanisms. So totally eliminating the fever is not our aim. We need to try and reduce the fever to a level that the child is comfortable with, and remember that the fever itself is helping to fight the infection. It's part of our body defense, and in most of the cases the infection doesn't need anything more than this supportive treatment. So we also need to understand that we shouldn't be obsessed about eliminating the fever. So the treatment to reduce the fever does not shorten the course of the infection. So it doesn't resolve the underlying infection. If the infection is going to run a course of 3 to 5 days, we keep giving the fever medications if needed till that time if the fever is causing problems. Again, if the fever is not causing any problems, if it's a low-grade fever, keep the child well hydrated, encourage them to take rest, and it should settle down. Even the medicines to reduce the fever are not essential. I mentioned the danger signs as to when you should review with the doctor in the previous video, so I request you to go through it. in order to know when the videos are coming out, you can turn on the notification so you don't miss them. So the basic steps to help the child. So treat the fever if the child is uncomfortable. And when we say uncomfortable, the child may be shivering, the child may be too tired, may not be interested in getting up from the bed. So if they complain that they are not comfortable and the temperature is rising, you consider treating it. If the child has a temperature below 39 degrees, which is 102.2 degree Fahrenheit, it's low grade fever. And the child is active and playful, you don't need to treat. However, you keep checking. If it continues to rise, you start treating it so you can preempt symptoms. So headache may also be a manifestation of fever, even in children. Ensure adequate hydration by giving plenty of fluids. This is key in any infection. Water is one of the essential things we need, and hydration is very important. Usually they are thirsty as well because fever produces dehydration. So encourage them to keep drinking. And some of the medications, as we will discuss, like ibuprofen, may affect the kidneys if the child is dehydrated. So again, it's important to keep them well hydrated. We should not have excessive clothing. At the same time, they should be adequate clothing. So you can have full sleeve clothing or bed pajamas for them, so they are fully covered, because exposure makes them feel colder. As I said, the thermostat is reset. The body perceives the temperature is cold outside, and they start doing things to maintain the temperature. So you actually need a reasonable cover when you have fever. Ensure the room temperature is not too warm, which can put the temperature up of the body, or too cold either, as you are not going to be comfortable if the temperature is cold when you have a fever. If fever continues to rise, you could treat with medication. In this part, I would discuss about chills. Chills are basically muscle tremors, which is one way for the body to increase heat production. So during the fever episodes, the body reacts in a way to increase the body temperature, as I said earlier. And by increasing the muscle contractions during shivering, the temperature goes up. So the body senses that you need more heat. It makes the muscles contract, and that's what chills is. And because the body is perceiving it as a cold environment and starts shivering, giving the child a cold bath or taking them to the washroom, which is usually colder, to give them a sponge or shower is not a good idea. So they will be uncomfortable. Obviously, they are children. They may not complain too much. They follow what you do. But you should understand the same thing you feel when you have a fever applies to the kids as well. So you don't want to get out of bed. You don't want that comfort level. When you actually get up, you start feeling colder because the inside the rug or the shawl, you feel more warm. When the shawl is removed, the body mechanisms to produce the heat again sets in because the external temperature is lower. So that's why when we have a fever and when we come out of our duvet, we start shivering a bit. So giving a comfortable shawl or equivalent improves the comfort level. You could consider medication for the fever during this period, as it's one of the signs of discomfort, as I explained earlier. Don't make the room temperature cooler in this situation, as shivering might worsen. So medications do help with the fever, and most of the mechanisms act on the central thermostat by reducing the perception of need to increase the heat. So paracetamol is one of the commonest and safest options to treat fever. It's often used as a first-line medication, and it is well tolerated. It acts by altering the response of the body control system causing the fever. High dosing and repeated dose can cause liver toxicity. One of the important things we should remember, if there are adults who take paracetamol regularly, is to use childproof lock for the paracetamol tablets, because sometimes we come across paracetamol poisoning from the child taking one or two tablets even of paracetamol. For adults, of course, you need 8 to 10 tablets to cause a significant problem, but paracetamol poisoning is one of the common poisonings we see in the emergency, so keep your medicines locked away. For parents, you usually have the dose that your pediatrician has recommended. However, it is good to know if you have a doubt to double check. So 10 to 15 milligram per kilogram body weight per dose. Most of the pediatricians give closer to 15 milligram per kilogram body weight per dose, as the safety margin is quite good for paracetamol. We don't usually see side effects. So you can look at 10 to 15 milligram per kilogram per dose, and the repeat dose is to be given 6 hourly as far as you can. Earliest you can repeat it is 4 hourly, but you shouldn't give more than 4 doses in 24 hours for the above reasons. If you do have the preparation, you need to know exactly how much is there. If it is a drops, we speak of milligram per ml. So the most commonly available drops like Adal have 100 milligram per ml, and your dosage will depend on that. For example, in a 10 kilo child, if you give 15 milligram per kilogram, you can give 1.5 ml per dose. And in syrups, usually we have two strengths, the infant strength and the child strength. Infant strength is up to 6 years of age, or for heavier kids, you can change over by 4 years of age. And it is 120 to 125 milligram per 5 ml. There are also preparations which have 160 milligram for 5 ml. So please read the label carefully depending on what you have. And you can stick to one preparation because the child is used to the taste. And older kids, paracetamol usually has 250 milligram per 5 ml. So again, don't mix up. If you have two kids of different ages, be clear about which medicine is for which kid. If you want to stick with the same medicine, you may have to give a lower dose for the smaller baby if you are using the older kids' paracetamol. Of course, the taste is different, and the one for younger kids is usually more tasty. In young infants, follow the physician advice, and if the baby is under 3 months of age, if there is a fever, do not self-treat. Coming to the route of treatment, so we have both the oral route and the rectal route. And one thing we should remember, that rapid reduction of fever is not necessary. So if the fever is high, a drop in temperature could take 1 to 2 hours, and our aim is not to normalize the fever, it's to reduce it and to prevent it rising. So if it is a high temperature, obviously we don't want it rising more. It can make the child more uncomfortable. The child may develop chills and so on. So you want to prevent progression of the fever, but a little fever, as I said, helps you to fight the infection. So your aim is to reduce it and avoid progression. It's not to keep giving the medication to maintain a normal temperature. And remember, if you overdo treatment, baby child may get cold. So sometimes we get a temperature of 35 or 35.5 after you have given the medicines, because sweating is one of the responses, and cooling happens with evaporation, and the sweating evaporating causes the body temperature to drop. Oral treatment is preferred because it's a natural way of giving any medication. It's quite effective. It acts within half an hour or so, and it is adequate in most instances. Injections are restricted to patients in the intensive care who are unable to take orally and you want a rapid decrease. The suppository form is an alternative option. It's safe to use, but at the same time, remember that it's not going to be too comfortable. It's not a natural route. Nobody likes to be poked through the bum. And the same applies to your child. They may not complain again. They trust you as a carer, and they expect you to do the right things for them. So remember that a suppository is convenient. Obviously, you don't need to beg the child to take it. At the same time, you get into the habit. The parents feel that the child doesn't take the oral medicine, or he spits it out, and then they go for the suppository route on a repeated basis. So remember that even psychologically, there is an anal complex. The child between 1 and 3 years is quite sensitive about the anal area, and we don't know about what self-confidence issues will produce in them if you keep using the suppository route. In Western countries where we have worked, I mean, most of the centers use suppository only for emergency. Unfortunately, in the UAE, quite a lot of pediatricians prefer the suppository route, and the parents stick on with that. So this is an appeal to both families and pediatricians who are watching this. Suppository route is not any different from the oral route in majority of the instances. If we do argue that the child doesn't allow oral medication, the approach is due to poor parenting at the start. So we need to start early with the right response to the child's reaction, similar to what we discussed under picky eating. I would refer you to watch the video on picky eating as well as the video on discipline for you to understand that we do need to start young. If the child starts opposing, starts throwing tantrums, and you are caught between a tantruming child and treating the fever, you may end up taking the easier route. But you start right from the beginning, then it's easier. Use the suppository only if the child is sleeping or repeatedly vomits oral medicine and the child is significantly having fever. So unless it's a significant fever, you don't need to treat it again. Consider using a lubricant like petroleum jelly externally before inserting in the anal opening. This is the shape of the suppository, so the pointed end is to go into the anal opening, and a lubricant is useful. Keep it in the fridge so that it's firm when you use it. and you can hold it for 2-3 minutes outside, so it starts smoothening. So in that case, you may not need the lubricant. Hold the thigh together for a couple of minutes after inserting, because if you release the thigh, the child may push it out and then it doesn't help. And remember that the formulation is the same as for the oral medicine. So if you have given the rectal route, the next dose of paracetamol, whether you give it orally or rectally, should be after 6 hours. So it is counted as a dose, and don't be confused. Don't think that this is a different medicine. If it's paracetamol suppository, it's the same medicine as the oral medicine. Ibuprofen is a commonly used second line treatment, and it can be used as a first line in some patients. Some parents prefer ibuprofen because they say it works better on their child. It does have a slight longer lasting effect, and it's a stronger NSAID compared to paracetamol. The dose is 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram per body weight, per kilogram body weight per dose every 8 hours as needed. So it's important to give it as needed based as its symptomatic treatment. We have discussed that part. It should not be used below 6 months unless it's recommended by the pediatrician. So paracetamol is a safer medicine under 6 months of age. In the first 3 months, we very rarely use ibuprofen at all. 3 to 6 months, if the pediatrician advises, you may consider giving it. There is no benefit of routinely alternating with paracetamol. So both these medicines are only on as needed basis. It can be given if the fever is still high and the child is in distress after 1 to 2 hours of giving paracetamol. Oral suspension of ibuprofen is usually 100 milligram per 5 ml strength. So in a 10 kilo child, the dose range is 50 to 100 milligram or 2.5 to 5 ml per dose. So in terms of ibuprofen, because it has the gastric upset side effect and the possible side effect on the kidneys if the child is not hydrated, I prefer to give a lower to the intermediate dose. So for a 10 kilo child, I may suggest 3.5 ml dose, though you can safely give a 5 ml dose as well. So follow the advice of your pediatrician. Again, if the child's fever is not too high and you're giving it because you think the child has chills or is uncomfortable, you can go for a lower dose. If the child's fever is significantly high, like more than 39.5 or so, you can directly go for a higher dose on the higher range. So other NSAIDs, the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like diclofenac are not recommended by guidelines like UK guidelines or the American Academy guidelines, and FDA doesn't approve these medicines for treating fever. These are strong pain relieving medication, anti-inflammatory medication, so their purpose is not treating fever, though fever does reduce because it's part of the inflammatory mechanism in the body. It can be used in some situations under direct medical supervision. Having a previous febrile seizure is not a reason to straight away use diclofenac, as we will discuss next. It's not available in oral form for children in a syrup form. Only suppository is available in the 12.5 and 25 milligram strength. As the NSAIDs get stronger, their effect on the gastric upset as well as the renal injury might increase. So there is a higher risk of gastric upset and vomiting. And if the child is not adequately hydrated, we need to ensure there is adequate hydration, as it can cause renal toxicity as well. So avoid diclofenac for fever unless it's essential. What describes essential is the fever going to very high levels like 40 and not reducing with a routine first-line medication like ibuprofen or paracetamol. Other measures can be used, like environmental measures, keeping the room temperature right, keeping the clothing level right, as we discussed earlier. Tepid sponging can be used. Remember that it is not cold sponging. Any cold touch when you have fever is perceived with shivering, so it's not comfortable. Tepid sponging works the same way as evaporation produced cooling. So when you put slight tepid sponging spread on the chest, there is cooling produced by that process, and so it may help to drop the temperature. So again, if the child is comfortable with the fever, there is no need to do anything. If the child is uncomfortable, start with the medication like paracetamol. If it doesn't reduce after 1 to 2 hours, you can consider either tepid sponging or going for a second medicine like brufen. If there is reduced appetite, do not force feed the child. It's normal to have a reduced appetite with any infection. Viral infections cause reduced eating, but ensure adequate water intake. We should monitor the urine output, and sweating after medication for fever is expected. Most infections are viral, and antibiotics are only needed if there is a high likelihood of bacterial infection. Other symptomatic treatment like nasal saline or oral rehydration solution can be used as per the condition. So last part is about febrile seizures, and I would recommend you to watch the discussion with the neurologist, Dr. Vivek, on febrile seizures. There are around 5% of children having a vulnerability of the developing nervous system to effects of fever. So it's a combination of genetic predisposition and the environmental factor here, which is the fever. Majority of the febrile seizures occur within 24 hours of the onset of fever. Family history is common, as an affected parent or sibling increases the risk significantly. Clinical judgment based on the variable presentation must direct the diagnostic studies. If it's typical of febrile seizures, we may not need a lumbar puncture, and it can be considered in infants younger than 12 months or with atypical febrile seizures, or where there is a strong suspicion of meningitis like neck rigidity. Around 30 to 40% of children who had a febrile seizure once will have a recurrence during early childhood. And children with complex febrile seizure are at risk of developing epilepsy, and sometimes prophylactic medications may be used in this group. The prognosis is favorable, as the condition is usually benign and self-limiting, even with the atypical or with the recurrent febrile seizures. Intervention to stop the seizure is often unnecessary, as usually the seizure stops within 2-3 minutes. Febrile status epilepticus, where the seizure persists longer, is very rare. And if the seizure lasts more than 5 minutes, you can call the ambulance and be ready to take the child to hospital. So parents should be aware of first aid on how to position the child, avoid choking during the seizure. So turn the child to a recovery position to the side, so the oral secretions do not block or choke and the tongue doesn't fall back and obstruct. So keeping the airway open and waiting for the fits to stop is the main thing. Don't restrain the child strongly, but make sure there is no injury. There is no definite role for routine preventive anticonvulsants during fever. Aggressive fever treatment also may not prevent, so don't be paranoid about it. Don't overdo your medication thinking you're helping, because sometimes a febrile seizure comes even before you realize the child has fever, and giving regular medications doesn't prevent it as well. So to summarize, parents should be aware of all the important aspects of fever management, because it's a common problem we often overtreat. Sensible approach is important, so we should be aware of when to seek timely medical attention. So we shouldn't delay medical attention. At the same time, panic is also not needed. Symptomatic treatment is purely for symptom relief. Treatment of fever is a form of symptomatic treatment as well. So we have discussed that elaborately, so I'm not repeating it. So use it only if needed. Fear of febrile seizure should not make you overtreat. Avoid strong NSAIDs, avoid suppositories as far as you can. Stick with simple treatment, and I hope this helps. We will be coming up with a few more videos on infections in children, how to differentiate bacterial or viral infections, because majority are viral and don't need antibiotics. When we consider specific problems like urinary tract infection, acute gastroenteritis, and so on. So I hope this video helps, and thank you for watching it. Do subscribe and share, and as I said earlier, turn on the notifications next to the subscribe button so that you can receive information when new videos come.